Monday Night Raw, the review every single Monday night. When it goes down here on the Joe Cronin Show, you have to click the like button and stick the thumb where it don't belong, and that's in my sphincter. Leave a comment down below. Subscribe if you're brand new. We're about to get into it. Maurice looking, wow. Let's just be honest about what Maurice looks like, and that's absolutely fire is what Maurice looks like. It's Monday night, WWE. I believed this show was, I felt this show was pretty pathetic tonight myself, but there are some people that loved it, I guess. I don't know. Maybe you loved it out there. Maybe you like it, you hate it. We're going to talk about it. Look at his look. How he looks.
And look at his look! How he looks!
Well, it wasn't a whole lot to look at tonight. Wasn't a lot to look at tonight, everybody. Oh, boy. Hit me with that intro. Hit me with that intro.
When Raw, SmackDown, WWE. Or AEWN. Tune in to the Joe Cronin Show. Live on YouTube for review and reaction. Joe Cronin and Jake break down all the action. All of it. The Joe Cronin Show. Your source for wrestling opinions, news, and insanity. A wrestling podcast with attitude. Mature audiences only. Join our community of over 70,000 people. Subscribe free on YouTube to the Joe Cronin Show.
Well, tonight was not a fun night to be subscribed to WWE, man. This was a slow burn bore, in my opinion. A absolute slow burn bore fest. I did not appreciate this show much at all. I'm trying to figure out in my mind the redeeming qualities of this show tonight, and I don't, you know, I guess there wasn't a lot of botches. Maybe that's, you know, wasn't a ton of botching or something. You know, I'm trying to think of what to say. There were some progressive storylines or some progression to some storylines, but oh my God, jumping lily pad. I don't even know. I don't want to say it. This show tonight was rough to watch, man. This is a very rough show to watch tonight, for my opinion. Now, if you're out there and you liked it, we're going to be skimming the comment section, trying to determine just who you are out there who enjoyed this. I know one guy that enjoyed it, and his name is Vincent Kennedy McMahon. He probably enjoyed it. I mean, I'm assuming Vince enjoyed this. You know? He had to have enjoyed this. Vince McMahon must have been popping a cherry out back somewhere. I don't know how he can do it. There ain't no chance in hell that I enjoyed this show or that anybody with a brain enjoyed this show. I can't imagine, but like I said, you never know. You never know. It's the WWE Monday Night Raw review for January 17th, 2022 here on the Joe Cronin Show. We are on our ninth year, on our way to 10 years in a row of live reviews after every single WWE Raw review or every Raw. Obviously been reviewing WWE on this channel since 2000 or on YouTube since 2006 in one way or the other, but live since 2013. It's hard to believe it. Womp in the chat is ready to assassinate himself, which is always lovely. We got Rustafa in the house tonight. He's coming in to go over the show, Jake DeMarco style, for me, so we can follow his notes from beginning to end, and we'll talk about it in a minute. Off the top of my head, there's nothing memorable tonight, really. You know, I mean, Kevin Owens and Seth are they're kind of funny together, but it's like the material is so safe that there's nothing really magical that's going to happen. There's nothing memorable that's going to happen. There's nothing magical that's going to happen because it's too friggin' safe, Vince. It's too safe. It's like Linda McMahon in the bedroom. I know she's got a safe word, but Vince McMahon don't have a safe word. Vince McMahon, if he had a safe word, it would be do it again. You know, Vince McMahon doesn't have a safe word. Vince McMahon says cornhole me, screw drive me, beat me till my anus bleeds. But I'm sure Linda has had one for years. It's probably stop it is probably the safe word. But there is no need for that whatsoever on Raw because the whole thing is just so safe and generic that nothing really could amount out of this thing. Nothing really major or good can come out of Raw because it's just so safe. It's safe, man. It's like wearing three condoms. You know what I mean? When you're penetrating her. You know, three condoms down below. We'll see what happens. It's just sad at this point. This show is sad. I see it in the chat, man, people hitting that like button. We got about 200 votes right now on Raw, and this isn't good for WWE. 11% of you said amazing. You might be brain dead. 12% said okay, and 23% of you said blah. Which means that over 70% of you gave this a thumbs down tonight. And 52% of you, which is half of you, said this was absolute garbage tonight. So I'm probably in the absolute garbage category because it was so unimaginative. Maybe I could get into blah category a little bit. But, man, this is a rough show tonight, man. Let me tell you something, man. This was a rough show to get behind. I'm trying to think of something positive about it. I mean, at least that from beginning to end, they hit their cues. There wasn't too many botches, I guess. But good Christ, man. This was a rough show to watch, and it's going to be, I got some things here, but it's, wow. I don't know. I'm going to go real quick dive into the donation.
Super Chat Party!
Oh, yeah?
Alex Oley is coming in.
3/5 couple of takeaways, though. Beth Brickingle was good. Priest Owen's finish made sense. Hurt Business may be problem for Lashley at Rumble.
Yeah, it's true. I liked the brick and the purse. That was really good. What I didn't like was Beth's promo. Like, I just didn't like her promo. Was number one, it was similar to Edge's, but also it's just the same promo. Will you please shut the hell up, or will you please shut up? It's like, I think I speak for everyone when I say, will you please shut up? That's like a thing that's been written 900 times. It's like, dude, how many times is someone different going to say that? You know what I mean? It's like, can you think of something else? Like, say something different. Hey, Maurice, I don't know if you know this, but everybody in here wants you to shut the hell up. You know, hey, Maurice, I don't know if you know this, but everybody in here wishes they weren't here because your voice is irritating. Or, hey, Maurice, you know, every time you speak, something inside me dies. Or, hey, Maurice, you speaking is like nails on a chalkboard. It's like I'm having my eardrums ripped out of my head. Out of my ears. It's like I'm having my head stomped on. I'd rather be run over by a steamroller than listen to your voice. Hey, Maurice, everything you say makes everything inside of me die. Hey, Maurice, everything you say bothers me, and the more you speak, the more I want to hurt you badly. Hey, Maurice, everybody in here doesn't want to hear from you. Trust me. Look at their faces. They have sad faces right now, Maurice. You're making people sad. Whatever you want to say, but not for the millionth, billionth time. I don't know, could you please shut up? Or it's just the same line a million times because the same person probably said, yeah, say that line thing that we write all the time. All right. Anyway, Rustafa's here. What's up, man?
What's going on, Joe? And happy Martin Luther King Day to you.
That's right. And you know what? Something different tonight. You know what that was?
About Martin Luther King?
I'm going to tell you right now. WWE, I believe, maybe I'm wrong, but WWE did not start the show with a Martin Luther King package.
Yeah, and it's funny because they did that in the middle of the show or like a third into the show. But I think that's also not the first time they've done that in recent years. So
really?
I'm not really surprised, and I'm not really personally angry about it. At least they acknowledged it.
No, I'm not angry at all. I actually liked it because every year on Martin Luther King Day, I believe, I don't think I've ever noticed it. This is the – okay, so first of all, they almost always start with the package right off the bat.
Right.
And also, sometimes in the middle of the show, they have like a follow-up version or something. And what happens is sometimes I actually miss it because I turn on at like 1 minute or 2 minutes after, and I miss half of it or something like that. Maybe that's what they figured. They figured, hey, here's where the most people are watching. Let's put that package in here. But yeah, so I thought that was a different thing to shake it up. You know, if it was me, I mean, you know, God knows. I mean, who cares, right? I mean, what am I virtue signaling? But I mean, I would have at the beginning like, oh, Martin Luther King Day's, you know, something up about him with a quote, and then I would fade, go to the show, and then in the middle of the show present the package. That's what I would do. But that's me.
It's funny, you know, whenever you have like a certain heritage day month. I mean, I know when they do February for Black History Month, they'll highlight a black wrestler like each week, whether it be Raw, whether it be SmackDown. And they normally would do that during the show. They wouldn't do it in the beginning of the show. The only time they'll really do anything in the beginning before a show will start if a wrestler or if an entity from the wrestling business passes away.
What do they do for Asians?
That's something you got to talk about with anybody that you know that's Asian, brother. I can't answer that.
What do you mean? Why can't you talk about it? I could talk about it. We can both talk about it. I just said,
I wouldn't really know, brother. Like, you know,
what do they do though? What do they do for Asians? There's an easy answer. It's an answer. It's like a.
I mean, you can probably answer it better than I can.
They don't do anything. They don't do anything because they don't matter. No, I'm just kidding. They don't do anything. I'm just saying.
I literally was going to say something. It was just like, nah.
You know what? Yeah. No. Well, I just want to say we'll come back to that in a second, but I will say one other thing though. And someone in the chat just said, "Well, Joe, what do they Oh, that's hilarious. Joe, what do they do for Hispanic people and Mexicans?" Well, Hispanic is fine. We could do Hispanic. Well, they do. No, wait a minute. That's not true. They do things for Latinos and Hispanic people. That's not
true. They do, actually.
Yeah,
they do.
Hold on a minute. Look, you idiot. Listen, I knew this was going to come up. I got it right here. Look at what they do for them. See, everybody gets a day. Anyway, go ahead, Ristoff. I'm sorry, everybody. Buenos noches. Follow that.
Buenos noches. How you doing, my friend? My God. Well, Raw was in Tulsa, Oklahoma at the BOK Center, which, by the way, this year marks the 101st anniversary of Black Wall Street pretty much being burned down. So I thought it was kind of ironic that it all falls on Martin Luther King Day, nonetheless.
That's kind of funny.
Yeah. Basically, Becky Lynch starts off the show. She gets in the ring, gets the microphone, basically says, you know, I'm the reason why, you know, all you people are here is kind of messed up.
You people.
You people. Pronouns, pal. Basically saying that, you know, she is, in fact, like, you know, the superior athlete and wondering why everybody's booing her when she's practically making the place. And how pretty much she's beaten everybody. And then, of course, she mentions Doudrop, which, again, is basically not referring to what she did the week prior, in which she interfered in that triple threat main event match and basically screwing over Becky Lynch and Liv Morgan. Then, of course, we have Doudrop, who comes out. And by the way, Joe, between you and I, ring attire. How important is ring attire, even if you're, let's say, a newbie or have been only on the roster for just a few months?
Yeah, I mean, if you don't look professional, you look like a jobber if you don't look professional. That's the thing we can say. Are you talking about Doudrop's?
Yeah.
Ring attire?
Yeah, and again, I understand, like, she came in, she was babyface, and she had her ring attire, but, like, if now you're a heel, I would expect you, besides just having a leather jacket, to come out and try to be a tough guy, be a tough woman, you know what I mean?
Well, what don't you like about it? Like, tell me what you don't like about it.
Like, for example, like, normally whenever I see somebody go from babyface to being a heel, I mean, we're also going to talk about Oh my god, the superhero gimmick.
Well, I mean, she's wearing a leather. Do you mean because she's wearing a leather jacket? So now that must mean she's bad.
No, I think it's just mainly is the fact, like, you know, when normally when you go from babyface to a heel, you'll at least do something other than just like a little something. You'll maybe have a new singlet, or you'll have this, or you'll have that. You know,
well,
what I mean,
at
least, you know.
Well, okay, I guess her ring clothes are the same. I mean, but they're, you know, are they? Can they really afford right now to get 300 yards of spandex from somewhere to put on this bitch? Oh,
you said that. I didn't.
No, but that's why. I mean, you asked why. I'm telling you. Like, what do you, you know, like, let's go. No, she got fishnets on. Isn't that new? She's more black stuff on. She's a little darker looking.
We'll also talk about that, and also the random ass like comment somebody made to you on Twitter, which, by the way, I'm so glad. I hope that you blocked him, because that was horrible.
That guy's purposely doing that to, like, he's purposely tweeting anybody who ever says anything to get in fights. It's a fun thing for him. He's not even a real person. Like, there's actual real social justice warriors. He's not one. He's just literally having fun. He's probably worse than all of us, to be honest. Sitting, you know what I mean? Probably at home laughing right now. Like, I got them all. He probably voted for fucking, you know what I mean? Like, he's not a real person. Go look at his Twitter. He's not real. That's why it's not even that big a deal. It was just funny. Did you freeze? The hell's going on? Did you see a cop or something? What's going on? Is this, Rustafa saw a white cop. I don't know what happened, but Rustafa just froze, and I don't know what happened. Look at the look on his face. Look at the look, how he looks.
And look at his look, how he looks.
I don't know what just happened to Rustafa, man. It looked like he saw a cruiser, something like that.
Yeah, the troll came in and practically tried to take me out. I got a better connection than that, bro.
Oh, on Twitter?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Oh, on Twitter, okay.
Yeah, but it's okay. Don't worry. We got multiple social media channels. I think we'll be fine. But yeah, going back to Doudrop coming out and basically telling Becky that she basically didn't do her any favors, that she won the match by her own some, but the fact that she made the decision to have Doudrop win was the worst decision that she could have made, and basically says that she has her number at the Royal Rumble. Then, of course, Bianca Belair comes out to a pretty actually good ovation, and, of course, saying that she's the EST, which, by the way, got a chant, which it's kind of refreshing for a change, because sometimes, you know, like, people could say something, and normally fans would captivate to it, and in my opinion, Bianca was actually the dominant promo in the segment.
I thought,
and then of course
she kind
of.
Her promo cringed me out. I don't know why. I don't know. I didn't feel her at all tonight. Oh, it was weird. She was the dominant promo. She's clearly like, because Doudrop's like kind of the heel, but so no one really is into her. But she's like the person in the way heel, and then there's the other girl who's the real heel, and then Bianca comes out like the hero basically, and that's what, you know, we got out of it. But I just found Bianca to be, I don't know, man, irritating or something. And I never say that about her. I always like Bianca, but I found her irritating tonight, and I don't know why. But it's probably the stuff they wrote for her, to be honest.
Do you feel like it's the same promo? Which, I mean, I kind of feel like it is in a way, but at least her delivery is better than most of the women on the roster. That's just my opinion.
I mean, not – yeah, I mean, her delivery is pretty good. I mean, her delivery is better than – I don't like Becky. Like, I usually can't stand Becky. But even Bianca is getting into that territory here. It's almost like they just become so horrible on the main roster, dude, because Bianca Belair, when Bianca was cutting promos down in NXT, I used to be like, ooh, like, she's really – she was getting kind of, like, sassy on people and stuff. But here it's so controlled that it's – whatever.
Yeah.
It was solid for her, though. It's just, and she executed the material that she was given beautifully. She read it, you know, and whatever. But it's just, again, it's like, you know, it reminds me of is like Drew McIntyre and everybody who's the face. It's like so bland. It's like, you know what I mean? It's not her. It's just what they wrote for her is so limiting. That's the problem. She delivered it well, though.
Yeah, and also just as a side note, I mean, I understand that Bianca, you know, just like Sasha Banks and almost everybody that ever came through NXT had a little bit more artistic freedom, basically because of the Triple H and the Triple H faction that was behind the scenes. But even so, I mean, I'll take this promo practically almost of every other generic promo, I mean, that's really coming out right now. I mean, again, with Becky, I find it that it's a good annoying type of thing because A, she's got the thick accent, plus she's a heel. So it allows more people to kind of be almost more annoyed with her. So in a lot of ways, it could be a good thing, not necessarily a detriment.
Yeah,
but you know, to each his own. So basically, yeah, Liv Morgan comes out, and all of them are about to have a tag match, which is what they do. Let's talk about this tag match just really quick. That finish was awkward as hell because I'm looking at this going, Doudrop is like a deer in the headlights because if you look towards the end of the match,
or an elephant in the headlights.
Yeah, we can go with that too. So
sorry,
Doudrop. Doudrop is pretty much about to do the finish, but then for whatever reason, she forgets that she's not the legal person. Now, normally you can do that, but judging by what the referee was trying to do and trying to end this match, basically because the backstage, again, wanted to end this match at a certain point, I can understand why there's that sense of awkwardness. So basically, she goes for the cover, says you're the legal woman in the ring. The referee says, drags Becky towards the corner, tags, and normally the referee does that tag signal where he claps his hands to the ring time, the ring crew or whatever, the person who rings the bell, timekeeper, and didn't do that. And basically, I'm assuming whispered in Doudrop's ear, basically saying, yeah, you got to take this home. And finally goes for the most generic splash, pins Liv Morgan, 1, 2, 3. Honestly, and you know what? Here's also another thing, Joe. I noticed that when Liv Morgan kind of like got the hot tag or when she went in the ring, she kind of elbowed Doudrop when she's in the corner. This girl is obviously bigger than Liv, gets on one knee and acts like she got clubbed right in the head with a hammer. Now, if I'm somebody her size or even Big Show or anybody like that and somebody gets me, now obviously, yes, I sell it, but I'm not going to sell it that much where I'm going to go down on one knee, especially when you're like 2 times smaller than me.
Yeah, it was a little weird. Liv's always strange in there. I mean, I think my favorite thing of the whole match is probably the end when the Doudrop fucking diving splash. I love the Doudrop, the dive she does. Well, that wasn't the end, I guess, but it was that dive she does. Bianca, her acrobatics, I guess, in the match were fun. You know, it's fun, her taunting, her athleticism. Again, I don't know, man. Coming out of this match, I liked Doudrop and Bianca the best in the match. I was interested with those two. I'm less interested with Becky, and I'm certainly not interested at all with Liv.
Right. And speaking of, shenanigans, thinking that this is not over yet, Doudrop drags Becky in the corner, basically does a Rikishi booty drop to the chest, basically implying that I pretty much have your number going into the Royal Rumble. And here's another thing.
And is that a new finisher too?
I'm assuming it is. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if it isn't.
Right.
You know, but you know, looking at this, I mean, and I thought about this. We have two heel versus heel matches at the Royal Rumble. We have Seth Rollins versus Roman Reigns, and we have Becky versus Doudrop.
That's really interesting. I don't know what the point. Are they? I don't know if they're trying to figure out who the fans will cheer for, or are they trying to set, or are they just doing out of necessity so they can set up, you know, the face? I don't really get that either. I don't know. I feel like everyone's
I mean,
name the matches again. Tell me the matches again. Say them out loud so I can visualize them.
Okay. Becky Lynch versus Doudrop for the Raw Women's title.
Right. So that's really just, to me, that's almost to cement, who the real, top heel is. To me, that's the cement of like who's the top heel,
right? But even so, we all know who the top heel is and who draws, right? And also who's got the gift of gab, so we already know who's going over in that match. And then of course we have Roman Reigns and Seth Rollins, which we'll talk about a little bit later, but just as a hindsight 2020, normally when heel versus heel matches happen, unless if you have a strong, like, you know, anti-hero type of character or promo, then it normally just dies in the water. I mean, case in point, I remember years ago, it was like Randy Orton versus Edge in like 07.
Yeah.
And they were both heels, but it started the show and the crowd were just happy to be there. So it wasn't really a big, thing, but you still are trying to establish that both of these are heels and both of them could care less about what the fans think, let alone who their next babyface opponent is going to be.
I mean, it's more of a Raw match that you would do, like Doudrop and Becky. Like, and again, but are they also sort of setting up Doudrop as a tweener type of, like, because she doesn't even seem full heel. She sounds like she's got this attitude or whatever, and they seem like they're trying it. That's what I can't figure out. Is that what they're doing? Like, I almost felt a couple weeks ago, I was like, wait, are they going to try to flip her back to face? Because they didn't, you know, they don't know what they're doing or, like, what's going on here? So I don't know. I don't understand that booking. It's weird that it's not on a Raw or something and then on the pay-per-view or, like, a triple threat or, you know, that there's something else that has to be done. So, yeah, I don't know. Maybe that's just something for them to do. It doesn't matter much. And to get them, I think Roman and Seth makes more sense because the fans will start kind of cheering for everything that's going on in that.
Right.
So that makes sense. But the boring one's going to be Doudrop and Becky. That's going to be like, people are just going to sit there like, okay. Like,
that's going to be the bathroom break match of the night. Because remember, we have two Royal Rumble matches, and they're both of them are going to have 30 participants each. Then you have, I believe, what? The, I believe a tag title match. We have women's title, two women's title matches. And of course, I believe the two heavyweight title matches. Yeah. So, we got seven matches in a span of, I'm assuming, 4 hours because it's one of the big four. Pay-per-views of the year, and also that doesn't just include the pre-show. So right. Most likely we're going to have 5 hours.
Oh, boy. Well, you know what, though? I got to be honest. Like, Raw sucks so much that these special shows for WWE right now, I feel like we haven't had a lot. I know that we just had day one, kind of, but these are way more exciting because day one was better than Raw. You know what I mean? Like, so this, that's the thing, is I at least like these shows because it feels like there's some kind of heartbeat there, you know. So I'm actually looking forward to it that way. Like, I don't look forward to Raw whatsoever because there wasn't too much to take out of tonight. But, you know, that at least these 5 hour shows, there's something to cover, the audience will be bigger. I almost feel like more people watch my reviews too, so I get more excited for the pay-per-views, you know. Like, there's going to be at least 500 people that show up to the review, if not more, because it's more interesting. So I mean,
I'm more so looking forward to, like, what the crowd is going to be like in St. Louis, because I don't know how many
seats
fill that arena. Well, I mean, we'll find out in a bit, but I'm pretty sure it's not like the normal Royal Rumble crowds that we've seen over the past couple of years where it's like 60,000 people in the audience. But I will say that this Royal Rumble, I mean, again, it could be like a day one thing where day one was just a better version of Raw, because we've even said that before, where it didn't feel like I guess it's not a pay-per-view anymore. It's just a premiere show, but it felt like a better version of Raw. It was well-paced, and the main event was short and sweet because, again, everything was done at the last minute. But going forward with the show, we have the Kevin Owens show is back. This time he has a necktie on.
And it's a boring show, yeah.
So, say this: Kevin Owens, for all intents and purposes, even no matter what he's given, makes the most out of it. He is hilarious.
Yeah.
Which we'll get into. So basically, they're talking about how, you know, Kevin Owens is going to go into the Royal Rumble, how Kevin Owens admires Rollins for going to SmackDown, to standing up to Roman Reigns to get all up in his grill. And, of course, they're talking about their big dreams and their big goals, blah, blah, blah. And, of course, interrupts the United States heavyweight champion, Damian Priest, and basically says to both of them, shut up. Another shut up promo.
Yep, shut up again. Hey, shut up, you. They were super PG tonight. No bitches, no bitch, no, none of that. That was really PG tonight.
I mean, SmackDown is less PG than Raw, if you think about it. But at any rate, you know, Damian says, like, you know, I'm about to have a match with Kevin Owens. I'm going to have it right now. And this is what makes Kevin Owens so funny to me. He says, I'm not prepared. I got a tie on. Laugh my ass off. I'm sorry. But, yeah, that probably was the highlight for me tonight. Because Kevin Owens, and I mean, if you remember, that tag match, it was Enzo and Cass, and I can't remember who Kevin's partner was, but there's that GIF that's online where Kevin's doing the Enzo dance, like back and forth.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm thinking to myself, you are a great heel, my friend. You need to stay. And then, of course, AEW then happened, and I'm like, well, either you stay or you go. You're still going to mix, you know, chicken crap out of chicken salad or vice versa. I'm just rambling. But
yeah, no, I get you.
But at any rate, then we have the match between the non-title match between Kevin Owens and Damian Priest. Towards the finish of the match, Kevin Owens is selling his leg, basically saying that, like, you know, he tweaked his knee, the doctor with Damian Priest, and then ends up hitting the stunner. 1, 2, 3. So
that was all right, like, kind of like,
does this,
oh man, you're fading.
So does this mean that Kevin Owens make Kevin Owens get a U.S. title shot?
I mean, I guess they're setting these guys up, you know, for this feud. You know, I mean, it's looking like, you know, Damian Priest, Owens at WrestleMania. They're probably going to have a long run and a long feud here going into Mania. I think. I mean, what else could it be, you know?
I say
put him in a ladder match, man. The only thing that bothers me is I don't like how the U.S. title is kind of the Intercontinental belt right now. I wish it was just the Intercontinental belt, but I say hang that belt up and we'll have a ladder match at WrestleMania with Owens and Damian.
I mean, I get what you're saying in terms of one mid-card title. Uh-huh. But for me, though, because we have two shows, we have the U.S. and the Intercontinental belt, so it only makes sense to have two mid-card titles. But again, no, you know, to each his own. But, yeah. You know, I just think that, like, yeah, just to go with what your point is, put them in a very dynamic match where, again, no rules and have some type of gimmick or whatever, and then it'll, you know, get over like Rover. But the one thing that I'm very curious and actually surprised that there's WWE is still going with this Jekyll and Hyde thing with Damian Priest. I mean, I actually never asked you this, but how do you feel about it?
I liked him the way he was, but at the same time, they were kind of, here's what I don't like. I didn't like when Damian Priest was acting like the good guy Roman Reigns and the good guy Drew McIntyre. So then they created this thing where he flips out and he's got this anger management almost issue or whatever. But now he sits there talking to Edge and he's like, hey, man, I just got this thing inside of me sometimes. And it's just like, that's just so lame. Like, they make him so, just like everybody, dude, it's so lame. It's like Kevin Sorbo. You know what I think about?
Hey,
I think
Joe. I got this thing inside me, Joe.
Yeah.
I got it all inside me, man.
Yeah.
I just got to get it out.
Yeah. 50,000 rape victims watching Raw tonight fucking had a got triggered tonight while watching it.
We're going to talk about that too later in the show.
No, he reminded me of Kevin Sorbo from, you know, Hercules or whatever his name is. Everything he does is like he's talking in front of a second grade classroom. That's what it feels like a lot of these guys do when they're good guys. And, you know, without the energy of Hogan or Macho Man or Stone Cold or The Rock or anybody, none of that charisma and energy, just a little bit of charisma, but it's cool, calm, and so chill that not interesting.
Yeah, he honestly reminds me of, like, a combination of, like, Razor Ramon and Big Daddy Cool Diesel.
Yes.
Like, put them two together, that's pretty much Damian Priest.
Exactly. That's exactly it, man, except for Razor had that, like, this extra charisma where I don't think Priest quite has that, but he has the look. He has the Razor look and the Diesel look, and he's got the Diesel promo kind of. You're right. It's just like that. And guess what happened when they were on top, right? It wasn't so good in 95, so that's what
the wrestling world wasn't good at 95, but I will say their work rate, well, not Kevin Nash, but definitely Scott Hall's work rate and his promo and his in-ring, you know, appeal was absolutely on fire.
Yeah.
But I will say, though, I mean, again, it's a different time. And, of course, Priest, you know, last year at WrestleMania had that really, astounding match with Bad Bunny. And, of course, going on against Miz and Morrison, which, you know, would you ever thought that a celebrity actually took the business seriously, comes in, tags in with a guy like Damian Priest, who then went from heel to babyface, and then all of a sudden they're like the talk of the night.
Yeah, that was crazy. I mean, dude, Bad Bunny, like, he won everybody over because of his execution. It's almost like because it didn't feel 100% right, because Bad Bunny did kind of like look ridiculous and it didn't seem right. But Bad Bunny, you know what it reminded me of? It reminded me when I'm watching figure skating, and the figure skater goes out there and nails all these things. And then, like, even the announcer starts going, okay, right here it comes. Here comes that double, triple axel, like whatever. No one ever hits it. You know what I mean? And then they do it and they hit it and you go, oh shit. Like that's what I felt like watching Bad Bunny. It was like this guy and these guys, right? And whoever booked the match, produced the match as well with him. They picked out all these things to do, all these cues to hit, all these moves to hit. They selected – these guys didn't select easy difficulty. They literally selected fucking like Bring It Plenty or whatever the fuck from Wolfenstein, like Kill Me Plenty, and they fucking executed every move. So it was like every time they hit it, the level just kept rising. So it wasn't like a fluid wrestling match that was a classic. But what it was an impressive, entertaining match. It's kind of like people that love the Fast and Furious movies. Like, I don't like action movies really that are dumb, but sometimes you go to an action movie in the summer, say Star Trek or something. Star Trek is not supposed to be an action movie. It's supposed to be a fun science...
Sci-fi.
Yeah, that makes you think and stuff. But now, you know, Star Trek's kind of a fun whatever. So I equate it to that. I was able to have fun at the new Star Trek, even though it wasn't Star Trek to me. I was able to have fun watching Bad Bunny because it was so amazing that he selected that amount of difficulty and hit everything. I mean, that's some insane shit. That's what I appreciate.
He put in more work than the Green Arrow guy. I'm not gonna lie. I respect his athleticism, you know, just to, you know, take cues and hit his bumps. But honestly, got Bad Bunny. And again, I hope they bring him back for another WrestleMania for whatever reason. Because
I hope they don't. I hope they don't. So he just stays perfect. Like I want him to always. I don't want to keep the anomaly.
Break the anomaly.
Yeah. What if he fucks up one? You know, something goes wrong. Whatever. It's like, but you know what? He could fuck up, and you'd still be like, it doesn't matter. I still remember that WrestleMania. But I don't know. Yeah, I'm like, go on top.
Sean Waltman did the same thing. When he wrestled Scott Hall.
Yeah, it's true. That's true. He had that one. Well, but, you know, and with Green Arrow, you know, he kind of took more of the, hey, let's do hardcore stuff. And, you know, he just kind of had to, like, fall through the table and do some other things. But, yeah, again, like, Bad Bunny impressed me because, once again, there were multiple people moving in multiple ways that had to be in certain places. Like, it can't be understated. It's, like, it's an understatement. The guy sold, delivered, performed the moves, and was in the right place at the right time several times. Like, it was, like, I'm telling you, man, like, that's a, it's almost like a one in a million to me that a guy, I mean, that guy must have done a lot of backyard wrestling. I mean, I'm thinking. I'm seriously, like,
you know,
thinking
what? He definitely played in the pool quite a bit, I'm not going to lie. He did moonsaults on his baby duck.
There you go. Like, he's been doing stuff. Like, I mean, like, listen, I mean, like, I've wrestled a couple of years, you know, and I don't have too much experience, but I got a pretty good amount of experience. That would have been hard to follow that. You know, say if Joe Cronin had a couple of months to get in shape and go to WrestleMania. I don't know. You know what I mean? All that, like, to be on that stage in front of those people. Holy shit, bro. I can't believe it.
Well, I mean, anything is possible. Anything is possible, Joe. I mean, Johnny Knoxville was practically in the Royal Rumble pulling a Drew Carey.
Yeah, right. Drew Carey just had to jump out.
He'll bump more than Jim Carrey, I'll tell you that much right now.
Yeah, I give that guy a lot of credit, man. Bad Bunny, he worked his ass off. He earned everybody's respect that night. Everybody made jokes about him, whatever, had fun joking about him. And, dude, that's how you shut people up. I mean, you either roll with the punches and laugh at yourself, which many of us like to do and can do, or, you know, you show everybody that you really belong there. And he kind of... He did that for sure. Like, that guy did that. He went, look, I belong here. I'm going to earn this shit. Even if he'd fucked up a couple of things, you know what I mean? It still would have been expected, and it would have been like, he did pretty good. But the guy went out there and just fucking stuck the landing. It was nuts. You're going to get me. I mean, I can't believe I'm giving this guy, you know, we're giving this guy as much time because it's impressive. The only thing that looked, it looked weird because he's so tiny and that was weird. But, you know, but again,
you got something against tiny people, Joe?
I mean, like, it's, you know, some of it wasn't believable is what I'm trying to say. Like, and I don't think the match is a classic. But like I said, for fun, I will watch that match again. I would watch that again.
I'll watch that for pleasure.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yep. I mean, that's not the worst thing that's happened at WrestleMania by far. That's somewhere in the mid-card. So go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, we're talking about...
Well, actually, wait a minute. Let me interrupt you. Let me interrupt you before we continue. Let me go to the donos.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
What if the turkey's a hater? What if they filleted us?
He's coming in hard with a big, long 5-incher. It's Soundwave 92.
What if the turkey's a hater? What if they filleted us? If the turkeys ate us, if they had to hate us, Thanksgiving was a little bit different. Instead, the turkeys ate us, they gobbled us apart.
Arlie Dixie
but
Carter's
first
ass.
They'd eat our nuts.
Oh.
And then they'd eat a butt. The turkeys ate us. What if?
It's not even close to Thanksgiving right now, Soundwave. Sith Negan's still up on the wall behind me from my drunken insanity the other night. Here you go, Soundwave. And Soundwave is going to take over the top spot here on Alex Oley. Thank you to Alex for the dono.
What if the turkeys ate us? Instead of mashed potatoes, instead the turkeys ate us.
Fucking cringe fest tonight. I can't tell if Vince is trying to make Austin Theory his adopted son or he is trying to get in his mom's sack. I don't get what makes this guy special at all.
What did he say?
His next opponent might as well be Hornswoggle after tonight. 3/10.
3 out of 10 from the top dog, Soundwave 92. And shout out to Really Mysterious, who's the king of Monetize This in the Wheel this week. RM, thank you. Yeah, man, I don't know. Did you hear Vince tonight? I had trouble again hearing Vince mumble around tonight. Did you hear it? I didn't hear him.
Dude, he's mumbling and bumbling and fumbling, to be quite honest with you.
Mumbling and fumbling
I mean,
and bumbling?
I understand the idea. I understand that he considers Austin Theory like the chosen one, a la Drew McIntyre when he was younger. But I mean, I will say this about Austin Theory. Like, again, it's something that Vince sees. It's Vince's boy. It's him that is ultimately going to push him and push him even further. But I will say that apparently Vince McMahon wants Finn Balor murdered. Did you ever realize that? I mean, he did admit that. He's like, hey,
yeah,
he didn't finish the job.
Yeah, he's always trying to kill Finn Balor. You know, Austin Theory...
Isn't that not a metaphor for his booking?
I don't think Vince likes Finn. I think he feels disappointed in Finn. Like, there's a weird message here somewhere, for whatever reason that is. I think he liked the Demon and liked Finn for a minute, and then he got disappointed in probably him getting injured the first time, and then something else the second time, and now he's given up on him, kind of. You know, I liked Austin Theory in the wedding. The only thing I've ever liked that Austin Theory did was that wedding on NXT. That cracked me up, dude, when he was like, yeah, we're in a ring. Like, that shit was hilarious. I was dying. That cracked me up. That's about it.
Yeah. So basically in NXT, he's a dumbass, but on Raw, he's just a chicken crap heel. So, okay.
Yeah, like he's a. I thought the dumb retard guy was funny. I actually thought that was entertaining. But I don't think and you know what? I kind of liked the heel when he was vicious, when he was taking pictures of people and he was like doing vicious attacks on people. But I feel like they've got off the tracks on that with this Vince McMahon thing. It's like, it's kind of like he's two different people. He can't be that guy now because he's too worried with talking with Vince, and I don't understand that. Like, just go let the guy just be a douchebag, and that's it. So, I don't know why they don't just do that. Let Austin Theory go around just being a prick like he was, taking photos with people, and make a social media account where he just takes pictures with people. Vince McMahon threatens to bloody and disfigure Austin Theory and send a selfie to his mom. I mean... I actually like that. I mean, this is right up my alley, you know what I mean? Like, I didn't hear everything Vince said, but I guess that's really is what he said. I mean, All right. Vince McMahon's a fucking psycho. I love it. You know, I mean, I can't argue that, you know, I'd like to maybe see that. So maybe we could see that. Vince McMahon just threatened Austin Theory with beating the shit out of him and then taking a selfie and sending it to his mom. I mean, dude, that's some savage shit.
Yeah.
That is one of the, I mean, that's right out of my book. Like, this is what the stuff where I get along with Vince. That's hilarious. I'll bloody you and then send the pictures to your mom. That's funny as shit to me. But
dude,
my problem with that though is that makes Austin look weaker. He actually makes Austin look vulnerable all the time. So all that stuff where
it makes the federal government look weaker.
Well, yeah, it makes everything look weaker. The bottom line is Austin Theory was on a roll with the taking a selfie of people and beating people up. That was great. But now he just appears to be like involved with an abuser. And you feel, it just doesn't feel right. I don't know. Like, I like Vince being a weirdo, but do it with somebody else.
Yeah.
Don't you think, like, if Austin Theory is jumping people and taking selfies with them, like, and he's going on Instagram and posting it and doing, that's his gimmick, and he just keeps doing that sort of thing. Fine. But why does he have to, like, meet with the Vince McMahon? Like, he's Shredder meeting with Krang every once in a while. It's just, I don't know, it takes away from the belief. I don't know, it just takes away from it. Something's not right about it. I don't know what it is. What do you think? Do you like this? I mean, I don't know what people think about it.
I have no opinion on this other than just the fact that it obviously, as I said before, that Vince thinks that this guy is a chosen, you know, the chosen one, basically.
Well, he's ruining him. He's ruining him. He's an idiot.
I know. But again, no, at the end of the day, Vince wants what Vince wants and not what comes out on television. And
so
ultimately, he has the final say, just like he had the final say on this next segment, the Alpha Academy graduation ceremony. Now, I've been to worse graduation ceremonies.
Yeah.
This one right here on television, though, might actually have been the worst one I've ever seen on television. Of course, Gable and Otis are the new Raw Tag Team Champions after beating Rated RK-Bro last week. Did I just say Rated RK-Bro? Yeah, that old. RK-Bro last week on Raw for the tag titles, basically saying, like, you know, Gable is the first graduate. I'm sorry, Otis is the first graduate of the Alpha Academy. So, again, these guys are the tag champions now. Will it be a short reign? Will it be a long reign? Who knows? But all we know is that RK-Bro have basically initiated their rematch clause and are basically going to be challenging for the titles again soon. So, and again, you know, of course, Randy Orton comes in and does his slithering, you know, out of nowhere gimmick, RKO's Gable, and of course puts on the robe and doesn't give any clap back towards his tag partner and basically is selling it like he just, you know, could do whatever he want and doesn't not care and does no harm. But overall, I thought the segment needed to do what it had to do, even if I didn't want to watch it. We got the rematch.
It was just a fun little thing. Little fun little thing. You know, it doesn't, you know, the only thing you can look forward to this, because who cares about the titles at this point? It's really about, like, can they have a fun story? Can they entertain us? And that's sort of what they did tonight. They had this stupid thing, and then, okay, all that mattered was Randy Orton gets in the ring and RKOs somebody. So that was fun, but that's about it. You know, it was like, okay, whatever. Little PG fun. I mean, that was one of the funner things to me of the night, besides looking at Maurice.
We're going to talk about that because I got some notes on this. But we're going to go to the Austin Theory Finn Balor match. Of course, we don't really have to say that much other than the fact that Austin Theory, being a heel, gets the win over Finn Balor. At this point right now, Finn Balor is not as... he's not as desirable to be on television based upon how he's being booked. And of course, anything that he had momentum for, even last year when he was going up against Roman Reigns with the demon character and practically that horrible finish, has really never been the same since. So my question
is, he's doing that with mid-carders now, you know?
Yeah, so I'm assuming Finn Balor as a talent right now in WWE. I mean, even if you put him on SmackDown, what are they going to do with him? I mean, at this point right now, there's no need to have Finn Balor in a feature spot unless there's a bigger reason why you want to put him in a bigger spot, and that's if he wants to go heel, which I don't even know if Vince at this point wants him to be a heel.
Yeah, I mean, I would either make him a full psycho heel or I would make him make the demon be back. I'd bring back the demon. That's about it. And I would do the demon with him a bunch. And I'd put him up against mid-carders. But, yeah, I don't know. At this point, Vince Balor is boring. Nothing. He's got the same 9 moves every match anyway. I don't like him. So I'm completely bored by him. He's booked horribly, and he's booked like they don't care about him. He's literally booked like almost a jobber. He's really an enhancement talent to enhance other people.
Yeah, I mean, he's the new Jeff Hardy. Think about that.
You're right. There you go. Yeah, that's true. I think Vince is done with him. I think if they had a spot for him, he'd go down to NXT to help them again. I think he's up here, like you said, to fill in for – he's in the Jeff Hardy role, like where Vince feels like there's nothing else to do with him, which I don't get because I thought merchandise and the demon – I think one thing that happened is he expressed that he didn't want to do the demon anymore or he wanted to stay away from it for a while. And my thing is whenever a WWE superstar – tells Vince and tells them that they really don't want to do that anymore, and eventually Vince in the office says, okay, fine. They sort of get spiteful at that point. Okay, well, you're a fucking whatever. It's like with AJ Styles. AJ Styles is like, hey, I don't want to be WWE champion anymore. Don't want to do the touring and be the champion guy. I have family and all these other things. I want to take a break. And they said, okay, and they took the belt off him, and then they sort of just made him this enhancement mid-card guy to make other people look good, which is fine because that's what he wanted. But I don't know if this is what Balor wants. I think Balor probably would still like to be a prominent guy but not want to use the demon so much, so instead they just went, okay, well, you're this now then if you don't really want to be that into it.
Yeah. Speaking of not being into it, we had Rhea Ripley versus Nikki A.S.H. And before we even get into this match, Rhea Ripley, has she fallen from grace?
She's again, it's this like, It's a person who is reading. It's a person who looks like they're full of character, who is reading dry bullshit written by the same probably white 5'9" guy in the back. So the same male writer guy in the back who's a boring idiot who went to California Berkeley School something of writing bullshit is there.
Full Sail.
Probably. Full Sail. Yeah, whatever. And they're probably not even good enough for WWE. They probably want those Berkeley people or whatever they are. They're the same people writing for everybody. So we get this generic, stupid, like bullshit from Rhea Ripley. This I'm so confident in myself. It's very similar to like Bianca too in a way. Although Bianca has that flavor, but I mean, so doesn't. Nobody seems like themselves. Let me give you this example. Back in the Attitude Era, and hell, back in the 80s, the 90s, the Attitude Era, and the 2000s, everybody is themselves with the volume turned up. But now, wrestlers appear to be themselves with the volume turned down. That's what it feels like. Rhea Ripley loves the goth look thing. That's what she wants to do. She loves music. She's kind of wild. Okay, I'm going to dress like this. This is my look in NXT. But we're going to sort of dial you down so that you cut promos. We're like, oh, step in the ring with me and I'll do something. It's like, dude, you're you, but with the volume turned down. Why isn't Rhea Ripley like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to rip your head off in the ring. Why isn't she like Luna Vachon or something like that?
I was just going to say, it sounds like Luna Vachon.
Yeah, exactly. Like, what, you know what I mean? Like Luna looked like Luna. You know, Luna looked like she looked and then how she looks. And then she cut a promo. She made sense. But Rhea Ripley, why does Rhea Ripley sound like a fucking, Rhea Ripley sounds like someone in school talking.
Honestly, it's kind of, her personality reminds me of Paige in the latter years, which wasn't really much.
Right.
And again, because when Paige came in, she was white hot.
Right.
Like, and no pun intended, but at the end of the day, Rhea Ripley.
Rhea Ripley, what did you ask me earlier about who? What's his name? The guy who looks like Razor?
Oh, Damian Priest.
Damian Priest. She's Damian Priest, but the female.
Well, but here's the thing, though, and this is what amazes me. Rhea Ripley, she has the size. I mean, she has, like, the Charlotte size in the sense where she's very tall, very athletic, can do a lot of great different spots in the ring. And again, I understand that WWE is trying to get other sides of her out there for the wider audience to get. And because, again, WWE's logic is marketable stars. They can go anywhere, be anything. But the thing is, though, just because you're a star on their program doesn't mean that you are a superstar in other realms of entertainment. You could put them on talk shows. You could do this. You could do that. At the end of the day, though, the believability of emotional investment on all facets doesn't really emote any emotion. And again, I'm speaking for myself. I just get the sense that they're just trying so hard with this trying to get people to be marketable when all you got to do
is. I don't think they're trying at all. I don't think I think the opposite. I think they're not trying at all.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, again, it's if you just give people bullet points, right? You give them bullet points, you trust them to go out there and do the promo without, you know, saying a specific word or something like that that's going to, you know, get sponsors a little, you know, which is actually another good point. I truly believe that the reason why they're scripting it the way they're scripting it is because they don't want to lose advertisers or sponsors.
Well, that's what it is. It feels like it's all done safe. That's what we've been saying for years now. It's all done safely through a glass, whatever, and it's all cookie cutter, whatever the fuck. And that's exactly what it is. That's why I say all these characters are themselves with the volume turned down. All of them.
I don't say that all of them are themselves, though. I mean, are you going to say that Nikki A.S.H. is truly herself? She's playing a superhero that's barely getting any traction even when she was a babyface?
Well, but, I mean, she's definitely dialed down compared to what she's really like, what she could be really like.
I mean, I can honestly see her, like, let's just say...
Dude, look at Nikki Cross in NXT. She was a wacko. Like, she's nowhere near that.
Right. I mean, again, she was like Daphne in, like, WCW in an Impact. Yeah, she was Daphne in a way.
So Nikki Cross is a bit hyper and wild in real life.
Right.
And in NXT, she was crazy. But in WWE Raw, she's a superhero. And now that she's a heel, she's kind of a superhero with an edge. But she's not herself with the volume turned way up. It's almost like,
right.
Again, it's like herself with the volume either turned down or sort of turned up a little bit. Like, that's what they do. That's why no one's getting over. That's why no one's over. That's why Seth is a little bit over, right? And Seth's a little bit good.
Oh, no, he's a made guy. He's over.
Yeah, but he could be better. So couldn't Kevin.
Yeah.
So they could all be better, but they're definitely better than everyone else. Like, I would give Seth and Kevin a 7 out of 10, but I think they're capable of more than that. And I think that, you know, Nikki A.S.H. or whatever is a fucking 5 out of 10. And there's nobody, like, dude, like, if you just think about, like, you brought this up a minute ago, it's a great point about, like, bringing these people on a talk show to the world, like, in, like, to an audience that never heard of these people before. If you brought AJ Styles on a talk show, you know, he would just seem like a sports guy and nobody would really know the difference. If you brought, you know, anyone from tonight's show almost on there, they would just seem either pretentious or, I don't know, like nothing special. But if you put on Hulk Hogan, you know, he would seem like something special. Maybe Brock Lesnar. Brock Lesnar, maybe Roman, but everybody else, pretty much not really. You know, but Macho Man, yeah. You'd remember him. If you saw him on Maury, you're watching Maury, and they brought
out
a wrestler.
Right, because the way that they presented themselves was outrageous.
Right.
And outlandish. But that was the 80s. We're in a totally different time.
But the 90s. Again, the 2000s. Go on fucking anything in 2000. You put The Rock on a show? You remember The Rock?
Of course.
The Rock would entertain everybody. You bring Stone Cold on the show? I beat his ass in the ring is what I'd do. None of these people, you wouldn't believe shit. You'd be like,
right, but,
okay.
But even Rock, and you only even notice this in his interviews, even in the early 2000s, he was very calm, very cool, but he still kept it in character to a degree.
Right.
Unless if he was like doing like a shoot interview, which was very rare. Unless if he was like in that guy Lambert, I believe his name was, in Canada, which, by the way, we never got until we saw it on YouTube years later. But
yeah,
I get your point. I mean, Nikki A.S.H. to me, I mean, if she truly wants to be a superhero and she wants to be a heel, I can literally see her developing I doubt it, but believe that she could be like that sort of kind of quote unquote, villain who thinks that he is a hero. Like, you know, again, hate to use a comparison, but like, what if they like did her Joker style, where they did her like Catwoman style or something to imply that, like, you know, in her mind, she's a superhero for everybody, but realistically speaking, she's a heat.
Right.
But again, no, teaches. I don't know. I digress.
No, it's a good heel thing that they think that she thinks she's doing something good and superhero like, but she's really being evil. I mean, that's a classic villain, so that's perfect.
Yeah, and it's better to get a reaction than no action, apparently, as Bruce Pritchard said. Which, by the way, we'll talk about Bruce Pritchard in this next segment, because God only knows what I was watching here. Now, I get the idea that it's Omos versus Reggie, which would be the next match. But before that, we have a backstage segment where Dana Brooke is trying to calm Reggie down and is basically saying, what is the game plan? And Reggie says, just stick and move, be quick. Now, this is the most random thing, because obviously Dana Brooke is the 24/7 champion. Everybody's trying to gun for her. They don't know how to beat her because they don't want to approach her and try to do as they did with the men, get a referee, kind of like the hardcore title, and screw them over by doing a schoolboy or something. But in this case, we have a random referee, which, by the way, is the most comical way of using a referee since I've seen since probably the Attitude Era, because referees are just doing their job in the ring or breaking up fights in the back. We have Akira Tozawa, R-Truth, and Tamina eating popcorn, watching these two talk. This was creepy.
Yeah, it was weird. It was cringy. It was bad. I mean, dude, almost this buried almost tonight to me.
Oh, bro, I sent you this on Twitter, and we'll actually go back to Twitter in a second, just because we have a lot of tweets that people have, you know, gave to you tonight, and especially when you give your opinions. But I said to you, Omos is officially even worse than Giant Gonzalez.
Right.
And we're reaching Giant Gonzalez levels.
I actually told Jake, I think I tweeted out that, like, Jake was right, because I give this guy the benefit of the doubt at the beginning. I was like, I think he'll be fun. You know, it's great. You know, he'll be good, and he's brand new, and he's somebody who's seemingly gotten worse somehow. And
yeah, well, again, they rushed him out.
Yeah,
I think he should have stuck with AJ for a little while longer.
Yeah, well, in all fairness, he shouldn't have been even on the roster. He trained for 3 months in NXT and then was on the main, like, that's
only
it.
Only 3 months?
Yeah, dude, he had 3 months of he was down in NXT working on some things, and then he really only had 3 months of training and active stuff, and then they put him on Raw as a bouncer.
I remember in 2020, and this is when Big Show was still around. This is how I remember. He was having a random match, and of course they have Tozawa along with all those other ninja-looking minions, and of course you bring Omos in as the biggest ninja I have ever seen in my life,
right,
looking like a mummy. And I'm looking at Big Show and him, and I'm thinking, okay, Big Show is going to work with this guy. Obviously, he's a big guy. He's over 7 feet tall, and you know, he's got his developing ring. Just because you're a big guy doesn't mean that you're going to be a big success. I mean,
yeah,
Kane developed and got better and better, but unfortunately, compared to Glenn Jacobs and Omos, at least Kane had more ability and developed quicker and was able to be adaptable.
Kane wrestled wrestled the wrestling circuit for years before he came into the WWE, and Omos, dude, didn't wrestle a second, came to NXT, began working out, lifting, training, and then worked on basic moves in the ring with everybody else, promos and basic moves in the ring, and then 3 months in was put in that bouncer sort of situation, and then he stopped training, and then they used him as an on-screen type of character person, and then he went back to training, we heard, and trained for about 2 months, and then he eventually came up to the main roster, and it was like, this guy didn't get, I mean, dude, nowhere near the training that he needed.
At all,
yeah, so this is like,
I don't know who trained this guy, but, and again, I know Vince wants characters to come up immediately the moment they see him, and again, this is another reason why I still criticize WWE, where it's like, again, it's not, I don't care how big you are. It doesn't matter. Like, do you have the ability, besides your size, to invoke emotion from an audience, not just based upon your appearance? And even if he had the greatest promo, that still wouldn't impress me. I care about what you do in the ring, because at the end of the day, that's how things start and end, in the ring.
Yeah. I mean, Omos came in, I think his first TV appearances were 2020, and that was when the pandemic was going on. when Raw Underground, though, then they brought him up. So again, this guy, you know, and I don't know. I don't know what his progression is. I don't know what he's learned, what they've taught him, and how he is. He could be very slow at learning. He could be bad. I don't think he's, God, I don't know. I mean, there's no language barrier like there was with Gonzalez, so he's got to be better than Gonzalez. I think he's better than Gonzalez, but he has better mobility than Great Khali. But yet Great Khali was more believable somehow. I don't get that. He should be this guy should be a slam dunk better than Khali and Great Gonzalez. He should be better than Gonzalez, better than Khali. That should be a fact. That should be a fact, but this is bad. So, and I blame them. I don't blame him. I know that he hasn't been taught right, and that, or that he, you know, has inconsistent teaching. And Vince probably thinks, oh, whatever, it doesn't matter. He's huge.
Yeah, but, and again, this is another reason why I wish Undertaker was still around. Like, he could take a guy like this under his wing, not even on TV, and just be like, this is wrong, why the hell are you doing this, do this. And again,
I wouldn't be surprised if he's called Vince and said, what the hell are you doing, Vince?
Undertaker, no, he's enjoying retirement, and I can understand why. I most likely know if Omos truly wanted help, he would ask for it, especially, you know, if there's an issue where he can only get, what, like 5-10 minutes with Vince in his own office during TV tapings, like,
yeah, like,
you know.
Well, if they're happy with him, and Vince, see, the thing is, like you said, like, this is a big guy, right? So Vince automatically just likes him and doesn't care that much, so he can screw up a little bit or not even look that good to other people, but to Vince, it's fine, and Vince won't say anything. So this guy's not going to say anything. Hey, someone help me. You know, he's not going to say that, and Vince is happy with it, so fuck it. And that's,
well, again, that's the attitude of Vince and Bruce Pritchard, because at this point right now, that's the result of, well, all right, I'm going to quote another brother from another mother that's on YouTube. It's not long-term booking.
Yeah.
It's not. And as a matter of fact, it really pains me to see guys who have the ability, trust me, I don't feel that Omos sucks in the terms of, if he truly wants it, he will learn how to not only be a big guy in terms of ability, but also learn when and when not to sell.
Yeah.
That, you know, if you can't sell, I can't believe you as a big guy or even a small person for that matter to tell stories, because ultimately that's what wrestling is, storytelling. But of course, there's sports entertainment. And apparently wrestling doesn't apply to them, nor does Kevin Dunn or anybody else in that company. But be as it may. We're on to the next segment, which we've been anticipating for all night, Joe, you and I. Maryse and Beth Phoenix. Good God. Let's talk about Maryse for a second. Now,
let's talk about her naked.
To each his own, my friend. But, dude, she... She, that was like the first time I've ever seen her look that way in like years, because she always wears her, like, her, you know, gimmick ring attire, and it's always, you know, a beautiful thing to watch. But dude, just her in leggings and heels was a huge change. And I'm just like looking at this going, Miz, you lucky SOB.
Yeah, dude.
How in the hell you got this successfully done, I will never know. And credit, and to be fair, I think she even looks even better than when she did when she first started. Yeah, I mean,
I don't know,
something,
man.
Something about the milk, man.
Yeah, I mean, I think she's really pretty and stuff like that. I mean, obviously, I think when she was younger, there was this, like, oh my God, I mean, it was unreal. Like, I think she's very pretty, like, very hot. I mean, I'm more around her age now, so she looks hot to me. I'm sure there's younger people out there that would, you know, think she's kind of an older person now, but to me, she looks young. She's a year older than me, actually.
She puts the new name in Cougar, I'll tell you that much right now.
Yeah, I mean, dude, no doubt about it, dude. She looks like she's 33, not 38. That's
crazy. She has not. She's barely aged. She's great. She's well seasoned. As the word in Dusty Rhodes, she's well seasoned, baby.
Yeah, she's just. I like her. I just like her. She's very likable. I like her. I like how she acts. I like her. Whatever.
What were you gonna say there, Joe?
I don't know, man. Like, I just. She's just really.
You got tongue tied there for a second.
Yeah, this girl's hot. Like, it doesn't matter. She's one of those people too. She could be like gigantic and she'd be hot. Like, she could have twin babies in her belly and get fat and she'd look hot, I think. Like, I don't know. But when she was younger, dude, she was like, when, like, if I was at a party you know, with like an ex-girlfriend or something, and this chick was around, it would just be hard. It would be like, this is, I don't know if I can fight this. This girl is captivatingly hot. Like, there's something, holy hell, bro. Remember the
speaking of captivating, we are live on the Joe Cronin Show, and if you like this show, please subscribe, and also, if you can, please like this video and stick the thumb up, well, you know the rest, I hope. Yeah, so,
oh
like,
my
this
God.
Segment comes... The segment comes on, and basically Maurice is basically saying, hey, Beth, we need to talk. Come out here. I want to face you woman to woman without Edge. Well, of course, Edge doesn't agree and comes out with Beth anyway. And basically Maurice is saying, hey, we should call off the match. I didn't agree to this. I have to clean up my husband's messes. Maybe we can have our kids have a play date. Interesting. Play dates during COVID.
Yeah, why not? Hey, listen, to each his own. Like you've been saying all night, there is no COVID for a lot of people. Fuck it.
Yeah, especially in the, we won't go there. But at any rate, I'm already going to start a crap storm already. But at any rate, so then Beth obviously shuts down Maurice and says, hey, shut up. The famous line tonight. And yes, shout out to Stewie Griffin. I definitely did check that reference.
Oh my God, I can't get over these pictures of Maurice. I'm sorry, I'm losing. I'm gonna faint.
Are we gonna rate these photos as we're gonna rate Raw? It's probably actually. You know what? It'd be a better rating than Raw.
Oh my God. I mean, I don't know. Other
drinking
than,
in man.
Other than some of the pictures I have of Leah, like I don't think anything's ever like this is unbelievable. But yeah, Maurice is just great. Love her on camera. And like you said, man, she'll be, I don't know, I like what they did. You know, Beth Phoenix, again, I feel like the faces are so lame. Like, the heels are so much more interesting because they're allowed to do something weird where faces just have nothing to do ever.
Heels like, have more freedom. I agree. Especially on Raw. SmackDown's a little more dynamic, but Raw, yeah, because apparently it's the A show, which we all know it's not. And speaking of why it's not the A show, well... The finish of this segment I thought was great, but it's just basically we understand, like, you know, the match is still on. It's going to be the mixed tag. We kind of knew that Miz was there, and we all kind of knew that he was going to do a sneak behind, but just I kind of just felt like the way it was done, I felt like they could have just had some blows a little bit more. It would have been better of a fist fight than just Edge eating Miz alive.
Well, is this not the third or fourth time now that they've done the, one part of – the Miz's group is like pretending to be upset and now they attack. Like, this is the third or fourth time in the past 6 months or less that this
is.
It's like, you don't see this coming. In fact, the last time the Miz did this, Edge literally said, like, okay, Miz, I'm not buying it. Like, you know what I mean? And then Beth said that tonight, hey, we're not buying it. You buying this? We're not buying it. It's the exact same promo that Edge had against Miz. She said, will you please just shut up? That's what Edge said. The last time he faced Miz, he said, Miz, would you please shut up? You think anyone's actually buying this? Like,
even if they added the word like heck or hell or something remotely just to season it. I mean, again, pull Chris Jericho. Would you please shut the hell up? Something. But of course, I mean, the finish of this, we both agree, was at least a creative finish because we haven't seen this in a long time where Maurice came to the ring with a pocketbook. And I only imagine it was an expensive pocketbook. Not sure if it was Gucci, but she had something in the pocketbook that I'm assuming Bruce Pritchard definitely approved this and gave this to Vince overall because this is like an old school Southern trick. Yeah. And it was gimmicked and basically hit Beth over the neck and head with this gimmick. They run out of the ring like scalded dogs, as JR would say. And of course, Maurice reveals what was in the pocketbook. It was a loaded brick.
Yep.
And in the words of a famous, famous song from years ago, she got a brick.
Do you know what makes this better? Do you know what would have made this segment better and funner and more realistic and scary? If you really wanted to get heat on somebody, you hit Beth Phoenix in the back of the head with the purse, right? And she goes down. And she goes down like scary, like where she won't get up or move. And the announcers sell that eventually and say, man, she clobbered her in the back of the head with that satchel or whatever, and Beth Phoenix has not moved. And, like, she's not moving and she's unconscious. And Edge is really concerned. And that's where it would have been nice if it had been revealed that there was a brick in there. Or like, and I don't mean like right away. I don't mean like they unzip it and go, see, it's a brick. I mean where it happens by accident, or like where the general manager comes from the back and says and starts yelling at the Miz and Maryse, and they're like, no, we didn't do anything. I just hit her. I hit her in the back. I mean, I don't know. I just, you know, I gave her a little punch. I didn't do anything, you know. And the guy, Adam Pearce or somebody, and rips the purse from away from Maryse, and he rips it open, and he holds the brick out and goes, what the hell is this? And they're like, oh, you know, and they're trying to get out of there. And like, for God's sake, what the hell, sick, you know, son of a bitch would, you know, what kind of human beings are, you know, Beth Phoenix and The Miz? Are you serious?
Yeah.
Like, and make it more serious. But instead it's like,
oh,
unzip,
my gosh,
look,
yeah,
a brick. It's a funny brick. But then have her being stretchered out. And like something, yeah, actually like horrific happened.
Yeah, honestly, or have like so many referees come out and aid her to come to bring her back to the backstage area. I,
yeah,
mean, you know, it's funny. You mentioned a great point, how the announcers are barely selling this to the point where it just feels comical.
And exactly.
I was just watching an old episode of SmackDown from like the 2000s, right? Like 2000, actually, the year. Mm-hmm. And like Michael Cole and Jerry the King Lawler, I mean, I remember like, you know, this is when, of course, you know, Kurt Angle was angle slamming women and all that other stuff. And it's just like, oh, she cost Lita the title. That was a damn shame. Like, dude, there, even then, there was more emotion in Michael Cole,
yeah,
than any of these three combined. I mean, it's really stupefying.
They're just all chattering hyenas at this point. They're all the same chattering hyena.
It's generic. It's robotic. There's no soul to it. And this is what Vince wants again. So, of,
yeah,
course, and this is my favorite part of the segment. And this is because
I
want to
sell the
thing.
Company. Oh, wait. Mr. Pico Boulevard. I'm sorry.
Super chat party.
Oh, yeah, Joe?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I'll eat rice aroni out at All Shells Holes Friday.
Oh, my God. This Friday, I monetize this. You're going to eat out of Shell's ass? Well, Really Mysterious is going to put his crown on the line when we spin the wheel again. I hope I don't get as drunk as last week, though, because I was out of commission for like a day. Mr. Pico, thank you. Got a couple more donos. Let me play them real quick. I see we're an hour behind. My bad.
Unload them all, Joe.
Oh, let's unload the donations on my face. God damn, man. Maryse.
How about in your wallet? Let's start there.
Yeah.
In our own city, oh, Philly, we're pretty, yo, this whole city, we're gritty, yo, we might
tonight,
eat our own city,
yeah,
come on, get it gritty,
in the city of Philly, we eat shitty, we're gritty as can be, we can survive off our motherfucking own feces, in Philly, we're gritty, in Philly, we're gritty, this whole city, we'll eat our own shitty, in Philly.
Oh, this one got censored. Greg the Banana. Cody can't leave AEW yet. He still needs to get his slave master gimmick over. Also,
oh,
I know what Dewdrop needs. She needs to lose 150 pounds. I'm not being mean, though. Just truthful, he says. What else did he say? Oh, my God. That's horrific.
Well, what do you
Jesus,
know?
Greg the Banana.
We got ourselves a new member.
Jesus Christ.
And I got a member in my pants.
That was Savage Donation tonight. Shell, 21 months as a member. Thank you, Shell, for becoming a member for 21 straight months here on the Joe Cronin Show. Greg the Banana also said, but Cody is a Sleigh Master, just like his. Oh,
wow.
Ooh, just look at his. At his what? Oh, no. I think the last word is. No, I'm not going to read that.
That's horrible.
That's fucking. Like, I don't know. On Martin Luther King Day, I mean, that's fucked up, bro. On any,
yeah,
day, that's fucked up. But Greg the Banana is obviously. You peel the yellow things of the banana, it's a white guy. So, makes sense. Greg the Racist Banana. Oh shit!
It's raining, Joe. It's raining.
It's gonna start raining, man. It's raining, man. Hallelujah! It's raining, man.
I want him to bring back this raincoat. This was great.
Absolutely so
those flamingo pink pants.
God bless Mother Nature.
God bless Mother Nature. God bless you, Mother Nature. Cause it's raining men and wet and
I hope when Veer Mahan finally is advertised to show up on Raw, his Titantron will be fucking so over the top with pyro and explosions, only to end suddenly with the words "Veer is coming soon" on the Titantron to close the show.
Let's talk about this real quick.
Oh my god!
Let's talk about this. I sent you the image of Veer is coming to Raw, and honest to God, this harkens back to Emma. When she was doing that Emma Lise or whatever that gimmick was, she's coming to Raw, and he just kept teasing it and teasing it and teasing it, and all of a sudden she appears and does nothing. And then she leaves the company right after that, goes to Impact Wrestling.
My God, he's here!
Do you understand what's happening? His name is Veer, and he's on his way to Monday Night Raw!
The Maharaja!
There's a new Maharaja coming! He's here to... He's here to end the whites. I don't believe it. so here's what's her face? What's her name? The goth chick. What's her face?
Rhea Ripley?
Rhea Ripley. This is what Rhea Ripley should be doing right here. Okay, maybe not this.
Our history is rich with pain.
It's your looser singing voice.
Violence.
Yeah, he puts a metal behind this.
Do it. Do it right now.
Oh my god.
I'll make this into a new donation.
I walk down that aisle, a princess, no a goddess, and you had to put your nose into my business where it never belonged.
She sounds like Danny Filth or something.
At least it doesn't sound like Bullfrog.
Our history is rich with pain and mayhem, violence, and evil. At WrestleMania, I walk down that aisle of princess, no a goddess, and you had to put your nose into my business where it never belonged. I beat you to the ground. The pain, and the anguish.
The pain.
The pain.
The pain.
The pain. Nothing. Oh no! I hunted you down and found you beaten in the First Nation, and then you truly witnessed my fury.
Shell Bryan says in the chat, it sounds like The Exorcist.
Oh my god, dude. Yeah, it sounds like a bad metal band. Oh my god.
Please make this into a donation.
That was amazing. Oh, that was pretty good.
It's really good. I put that over. I gave it 5 stars, Joe.
Yeah, I would say if you dialed that down a little bit more, but like, you know, like Rhea Ripley could come on and be like, Like I would like it if Rhea had a do you remember when Matt Hardy was doing the stories from the throne at his house?
Yes.
Give Rhea Ripley a throne where she sits sideways on it with her leg up and a chalice and she sips out of it. And she just basically
gets her goblet.
Yeah, goblet. And she like basically tells people how they're gonna be suffering, there's gonna be pain, there's gonna be this, that, and the other thing. And you know, whatever. Just have her do something kinda like demonic like that. And have a little more energy instead
it's too
of this
bad
like
we can't call her the pain maker. I'm sorry. You know, it's just wish we could have called her
the pain master. She's the pain master.
But I think that they might have to change her gimmick though to a dominatrix if that's the case.
Yeah, but so let's take a look. I mean, here's a Rhea Ripley promo. I mean, like, you know, you can look at tonight, but even recently, like the Rhea Ripley promo from, like, let's listen to her in the back here real quick.
Also,
like, this is not that long. This is WrestleMania time. Where's the promo? Here it is.
Being confident in myself. It was that self-confidence that led me out to the ring on my first night at Raw to challenge Asuka for a match at WrestleMania. It was that confidence that allowed me to beat Asuka, one of the best champions ever, to become the Raw Women's Champion. What the WWE Universe witnessed last night at WrestleMania was the brutal new order of the women's division.
We never saw it's that new order, though.
It is night and day from that time period to right now. And granted, I get it. They matched her up with, you know, Sam Ash and, you know, pretty much Nikki Ash, I'm sorry, and did their whole, you know, their whole gimmick and stuff. And she's trying to be empathetic. Why am I fighting my best friend? I get that. But honest to God, dude,
makes
at
no
this
sense.
Point, even she was like, I mean, again, this kind of reminded me, this team reminded me of RK-Bro, where yeah. Randy and Rhea Ripley played the same role, where it was like, you know, God, why am I in this tag team? Oh, but we happen to have tag team titles, so we might as well take our stuff seriously. Mm. You know, and it just didn't work. I mean, I just wish that
it's just,
I mean, again,
for someone who looks so, you know, cruel, like in goth and stuff like that, she's just so generic and boring. Why, you know, like, why isn't she intense yeah. or, you know,
well, I'll tell.
But nobody is, though, so it doesn't matter unless they physically go out there and break a table or something.
Well, I'll tell you what wasn't as boring, but again, no, it didn't really make things that much better, but we kind of expected it being, you know, faces over. We had the Street Profits and the Mysterios taking on the Dirty Dogs, Dolph Ziggler and Robert Roode, and Apollo Crews and Commander Azazel. Of course, there's going to be a commercial break. And by the way, I am not the biggest fan of multiple commercial breaks in the middle of matches. That's just my personal opinion. But I also understand that you're a major company, and these days you got to pay the bills. So you have to go for your advertisements. But, I mean, that being said, we go into the match. There's a lot of great athleticism, especially from the faces side. Of course, Rey Mysterio, believe, tags in Dawkins, gets the hot tag. Does a lot with, you know, all the other members. And, of course, we have the Mysterios come in. They do the 619s. And eventually getting the win as far as the Mysterios and Street Profits. Towards the end of the match, the Mysterios throw out the Street Profits over the top rope to act as if it was the Royal Rumble.
This got a huge pop. That whole thing got a – this got the loudest crowd reaction of the night, I believe. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I wouldn't disagree with that, actually.
They were loud for this. I don't know why, but
it got even louder, though, Joe, when Rey Mysterio dumped his own son over the top rope, which, by the way,
yeah.
Rey Mysterio, for all intents and purposes, even if you try to do something even heel-ish, at this point, like, you still take it as, like, you respect the guy. He's never been a heel. He's a babyface. Plus, also, Rey is also trying to teach his son, hey, things happen on a daily basis. You got to be prepared. So it was a nice little... you know, throw in for the night. It's probably actually maybe the only thing I really, really liked about tonight in terms of just like a simple match. It wasn't necessarily about all the, you know, everything that was happening, like, you know, in between, like, you know, one baby face and one heel. It was just leading up to the pay-per-view. It was refreshing just to see that. Going, I guess, now towards, actually, no, not towards the main event yet. We are literally at the Alexa Bliss therapy session.
I missed this.
Okay, so basically it was a repeat of last week, except this time Alexa Bliss basically didn't, like, smash up the entire room, and it was just basically the doctor was telling Alexa Bliss, hey, what happens when I give you the words trust, friendship, you know, this and that, and basically every response that Alexa Bliss came back was Lily, in reference to the doll that unfortunately has been ripped to shreds by Charlotte Flair back at Extreme Rules of last year.
Jesus.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm glad I missed it. That would have pissed me off, probably.
The therapist, I mean, the only two therapist segments in recent memory that I can even say were even passable or even entertaining was the Hell No Daniel Bryan Kane therapy session, along with the Dean Ambrose deal. But even then, that wasn't even.
I didn't, you know what? I didn't like those, and I didn't like those. But I know that I'm in the minority, though. I know a lot of people loved Daniel and Kane, and I kind of liked it, but it still was too cheesy for me. But
I got you. I mean, I was
I'd kill for that, though, compared to this stuff.
Oh, yeah, no, I was 18, 19 when that was going down at the time, and even then I thought it was kind of cheesy, but even though, even so, it was like, it's like Rock and Sock, you know, was it made to work on paper? No, but it worked.
Right.
So the Dean Ambrose therapy session, where basically the guy was showing him a bunch of photos and telling him his thoughts, and eventually calling Stephanie McMahon a hoe. You know, it is what it is. The fact that I even remember that, it stupefies me. But at any rate, after commercial break, basically they're showing Maryse and Miz backstage saying that their love is going to conquer Edge and Beth at the Royal Rumble. Oh, this is something I wanted to say earlier. Mm. So as Miz and Maryse were leaving, it's live TV, stuff happens. I believe something went wrong with their heel and they were trying to like dip or whatever, but it didn't really work as good. And then they kissed, but Maryse's hair was like in the middle of her face and she tried to like play it off. And they eventually got it right to do a second take of it. You know, it's what happens. But then they're backstage and they're making out like, you know, like animals, obviously. But, you know, I mean, again, I like the idea that we have, because we don't really normally get them as often where we have, you know, a boyfriend, girlfriend, husband and wife team going up against another one. And I like the dynamic of it. I'm still waiting for, in my opinion, I would like to see this. I don't know how anybody else in the chat feels, but I would love to see Becky Lynch and Seth Rollins versus Bianca Belair and Montavious Ford.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think that would even be a better program than this one, personally.
Yeah, I would have liked that more. Better direction, too. There's no direction right now. That'd be a direction to go. I don't think they really have one right now. So that I'd be fine with that. I'd like to see that.
Because Montez Ford, we haven't, I mean, I think he's great on the mic in terms of his presence, but I think there's so much more that he can say.
Yeah. Yeah. He's so much. Like everybody, he's sort of held back, I think. You know what I mean? Like everybody.
Yeah, and again, they are to me, and I'm just a side note, Bianca and Montez are just to me the it couple, not just because they're great athletes, not just because they're great African American wrestlers and are holding it down outside of the ring, because I mean Bianca makes like her own clothes and her own ring gear, and Montez is just a humble, you know, brother, also by the way, former Marine. Our active Marine member. He's still a Marine.
Yeah, Montez is like, dude, is like your the older brother down the street or something that is awesome. Like, not the cool older brother who's dangerous, but like the awesome, fun, like cousin.
Yeah, not blood brother, but definitely like brother. Like, you know, that's your homie. That's your, like, yeah, your best friend.
Dude,
yeah.
He is very, he's likable like that. Like, he's the guy that, like, if something happened and the parents had to go to the hospital, he's the guy who the kid down the street who would babysit all the kids and take care of everybody or something. Like, he's
don't tell mom I made it to the hospital. Just say I got a little flesh wound.
Yeah,
you know,
like, I don't know, man. He's definitely like very likable, very cool guy. They'll do well, two of them probably.
So does that mean that his partner is the Marty Jannetty of the team? And I don't want to bring that up, but I know for a fact some idiot online is going to be like, oh, why are you guys talking about, you know, Montez more so than Dawkins? Dawkins is good, and he is good. But I'm just saying, I think that Montez, to me, is going to be, like, once he – if they break up the tag team and he goes singles, I can definitely see him as United States or Intercontinental Champion and do amazingly well and have some of the best matches on the card, whether if he's babyface or heel.
Yeah, you'd probably have to turn the other guy Well, it reminds me of Otis and the other guy. What was that other guy?
Oh, when they were
Heavy Machinery.
Express. Yeah, Heavy Machinery.
Yeah, right? Now again, I think that was a fine tag team. I don't think they should have broken up, but I mean, you know, Otis had that different look. The other guy was fairly generic, and I think that's why, you know, I guess he left. I suppose he was like the straight guy, but he was also so generic that they got rid of him. And Otis isn't necessarily a Montez Ford, neither is a Shawn Michaels or anything like that. But, you know, he was the one that they felt they could do something. It's almost like they could turn – they made Otis into the side guy, but he's so different it works really well, whereas that other guy didn't even work as a side guy for them. He worked as such a generic. Dawkins is going to have to be a heel. He's going to have to be a jealous, angry, bad guy who turns very heel. I think it'd be great if he turned on Montez Ford. I think it'd be great if he threw Montez Ford through a glass window and was like, I'm sick of you holding me down, man. That's what you've been doing. It's you. Like, and you get this nasty look on his face, and he's like, fuck this. It's not funny anymore. You're not funny. Like, he definitely will play that heel character. But how long will he be able to carry that and stay in the WWE will be interesting. But Montez Ford, you know, he's a guy that definitely could have another 2 to 3 years in the company, if not more. But again, for Dawkins, he might be in trouble after a year or two.
Yeah. I mean, again, I hope they don't split these guys. I mean, again, for whatever reason, Vince has a hard-on for splitting tag teams up. I mean, even during the first initial draft in 2002, he
loved breaking after Enzo and Cass, I mean, that became, like, all bets are off the table because those guys felt like they needed another year or two. And,
oh, shoot, even go back even further with Crime Time.
Well, that's true, too, I mean, although I think that, honestly, I think some of the political, you know, I think they had some backlash from some things about them. And
the first run they had, and then, of course, you know, whatever. But even so, even with Enzo and Cass, I mean, again, Enzo was probably not, like, the most likable person backstage, even though he was boisterous, even when Cass and Enzo were still together. But, unfortunately, we're in an era right now where, again, tag teams are not WWE's focus.
Yeah. Vince never cared. He doesn't care. And that's why going back to the Randy Orton stuff earlier that you were talking about, you know, that's why it doesn't even bother me. You know, they just lost the belts. They win the belts. I don't even care. I just hope that the teams entertain me. And the fact, and this is the first time in a while, I feel like they never do this. They always, like, somebody loses and then they move on. I like that the good guys lost and that they're still coming at them. Like, we're coming back for those titles again. And it feels fun, kind of. It's not very good, but it's like, it was somewhat nice or entertaining a little bit. Not really, but it's only because it's Randy Orton. He and he's RKOing people. So, you know, whatever.
And he's getting that big paycheck, and he's been there since 2002. Well, technically 2000 in OVW, but again, that remains to be seen. He's a staple in the company. He's pretty much a lifer. Dude, here's the other thing that people tend to forget about Randy is that this guy basically had the three strikes, you're out rule type of thing.
Oh,
and
yeah.
He's still in the company. I mean, again, this is a guy, and again, he's admitted that he's made mistakes. He probably wasn't the most liked. And even John Cena said, like, you know, when they were in OVW, that he was a complete douchebag. I think there's even a story where apparently he put his crotch on, like, his wrist, or he put it on Cena's shoulder or something, and basically Cena didn't sell it. But that's basically who he was. He was just an immature kid who just didn't have any proper guidance in the sense of, like, just don't do this, just, you know, be yourself, but at the same time, don't be a douchebag.
Yeah.
And of course, he had to learn the hard way, you know.
He's he knows it, and he's gotten better for sure over the years.
He's got a good wife right now. He's got good children around him. He's making a great living. So there's really no point why he should, you know, at this rate, you know, not do what he doesn't want to do. But
he's just doing, he's in cruise control, man. He's revered. You know, and the other thing is he's from the old era, you know, in couple different eras, you know.
Third-generation star. He's the only third-generation star, if I'm not mistaken, still in the company. Active, right?
Yeah.
And there's really not that many third- or fourth-generation stars, even in the – I mean, probably more now because, you know, I mean, Brian Pillman Jr. is second generation technically. But, you know, and also Rock's daughter is still training, so she's going to be the first fourth-generation star in the history of the WWE. So, yeah, I mean, again, it just goes to show that, again, persistence is key. But at the end of the day, you know, and again, this could happen to anybody. But ultimately, when you have a lineage in the business, you normally get better treatment, or let alone not as bad of a treatment as if somebody who's never really done that much in the business prior or what have you.
Randy is too cocky and badass to let – you know, any of that bother him, you know, early on.
At this point,
who cares? That doesn't even need to be talked about. I mean, the guy's just, again, it's just he's basically now he's the Undertaker or Shawn Michaels or whatever. He's from that. He's that type of not performer, because I don't even like Randy that much in the ring and everything else. I'm not a big Randy guy. But, you know, I love his music, his presence. He's a solid legend. I just never was a big Randy fan. But, I mean, if I saw him and, you know, but he is a guy. He's a legit wrestler. A lot of these other people don't feel right still. Randy feels like a legit wrestler.
Yeah. Well, remember, at that time when he was training in OVW, and then, of course, when he came to WWE, again, he still had stuff to learn as far as, you know, again, selling, just the little things. I mean, I think even –
Why are you going back to when he was in OVW, though, and, like, how he was learning and stuff? That's so funny to me.
Well, no, because it's funny. I've been watching some old OVW tapes over the past couple of weeks, and it just amazes me how you had Brock, Cena, Batista, and Orton all at the same time, and Brock.
Yeah.
If I didn't mention Brock.
Well, that was when Cornette was running OVW, right?
Right, and even at that time, you know, you had Paul Bearer being, well, not being a stooge, but by other stooges in the company, was like, watch Danny Javis. Watch Jim Cornette. We're paying him all that. And Paul's not a stooge, you know? But I think, honestly, with Randy, I mean, if they really wanted him to be babyface or said, hey, we need you to be heel tomorrow, wouldn't have a problem doing that. But the thing is, he's different from Big Show when it comes to being hot and cold as a babyface or heel. They know how to book him right, which I can't say for the rest of the roster. And he's probably the only legitimate superstar in the company as far as like being taken seriously and can pretty much do no wrong. But, we're still at a point right now where even in the company, being a superstar is just a pipe dream.
Yeah.
You could be a star, but you can't be a superstar. But,
well, Alex Oley brought up what I brought up. He said, let's get to the main event, Rollins and Lashley. Who gives a fuck about Orton's past? I think you were watching a lot of OVW stuff and you got it in your head. I think that's why it spilled out. That's what I think you just said that. I think that's – well, I was trying to figure out where you were going, like why this was being brought up. But I think it's because you're thinking about the time, like how far Randy's come, and I think that's what we're talking about. But yeah, I thought it was funny that you were going all the way back to Orton. I was like, what the hell are we talking about? But I mean,
we're not going back to the 70s, because trust me, that would be a whole other conversation.
I'll get off on a rant that has nothing to do with wrestling out of nowhere sometimes. So I mean, I'm not one to talk at all. I just thought it was funny. Like, but let me go.
This is wars.
Here's Alex Oley now. Here's a donation.
Super chat party.
Who wins the Rumble? Very unpredictable. What's more likely, Brock loses to Lashley than he wins Rumble to face Roman? Or someone we don't expect wins?
Good question.
I'm going with someone we don't expect.
Same. I honestly, if it's a veteran, like, let's say, I doubt they're going to go with Sheamus or Orton or somebody like that. I mean, it could go.
Oh, God. I hope it's not either one of them.
Yeah,
The Undertaker.
You bring him back. If I was booking this, I probably would go with somebody that
I go with The Rock. Can you imagine? I'm serious. Can you imagine?
Really?
Can you imagine if the music hit and The Rock came out like 20th? What that place would do? The Rock. And he won the Royal Rumble? Dude, I'm going with The Rock right now. The Rock.
Do you remember Angry Grandpa and his kid, like on YouTube? Like his kid would watch wrestling and would break DVDs and get like a bunch of views for breaking every great wrestling DVD that he had owned. I'm thinking that's what's going to happen if Rock actually were to show up out of a win and win his second Royal Rumble ever.
Brock doesn't need it because they can just put him in any match at WrestleMania, so that doesn't matter.
Right.
It
doesn't matter what you do with me.
Dude, that would be so wild if The Rock won. He comes in 25th, comes in 30th, whatever the fuck. You know, and Brock is in there too. Like, I don't even know, dude. It could be nuts.
How about we do this, Joe? Who is in your last four, the final four in the Rumble?
The final four in the Rumble?
On SmackDown.
This year?
On SmackDown. Yes.
Is Seth going to be in the Rumble? Probably. So,
Seth is fighting Roman for the title, but again, no, they could put him in the Rumble.
Yeah. So I would, if the Rumble's last, then yeah. So I'd want Brock, Seth, and,
Brock's the champion though. They're going to put the champion.
Oh, that's right. All right. So I guess I would have Seth. I'm trying to think of who else is believable at this point.
Kevin Owens.
All right, Seth, Kevin Owens, Sheamus, and who else would be in there then? And then I would have I'd have The Rock. Lesnar?
Well, no. We have Seth as a heel. We have Kevin Owens as a heel. If you're going to say who's the other person that you just said? Sheamus, he's a heel. I'm thinking that what's going to happen is in the final four, we're going to have two heels and two baby faces. It depends on Drew, because again, I think he's still injured, right?
I would either say Cena or The Rock. It's got to be it's got to be a big surprise person in the Rumble, because they got nothing otherwise. Think about it.
Well, yeah. I mean, again, at this point right now, because I'm just still confused with the main event situation Because the thing is that we have Brock, who's the champion, the WWE champion. We have Roman, who's a Universal champion. They teased potentially title for title at WrestleMania, but that's still not confirmed yet. And even if they were to go title for title, you know what that means? It's still going to be a multi-person match, whether it be triple threat, fatal four-way, whatever, because you also got the winner of the Royal Rumble. I honestly, for me, and again, this is just my gut feeling.
You know, it'd be great. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, my gut feeling is that we're going to have title for title. It may not be unification, which is what I want. I just feel that somebody's going to win with both, go away with both belts and defend them on both Raw and SmackDown.
Well, I think if they can't get The Rock or Cena and all these other things to fall into place, I think it is potential that you'll see Brock and Roman. Like you just said, although I predicted months ago that it would be a unification match because USA Network wants, you know, Roman and every on their channel, because you know what I mean? So like it's one of those things where like, okay, now we can go both places, you know? So I don't know, man. I almost think they would unify him, but I'm just thinking, man, it's got to be something big. Otherwise it sucks. You know, this Rumble's going to suck.
Yeah, at this point right now, we're practically reaching kind of like a quasi WrestleMania 10, WrestleMania 2000 type territory where the booking is still up in the air, and yet we don't know what the final outcome, whether even if you're on the inside of the spectrum. I mean, Dave Meltzer, which by the way, I did not believe when he made the statement that they're thinking that they're going to drop Roman's going to drop the belt to Seth. I don't believe that at all. Especially even though that Seth, you know, was in that multi-man match at Day One. Didn't walk in, which, by the way, allegedly he was supposed to win that match if Brock was going to go up against Roman.
There, by the way, my picks are The Rock, Cena, and Austin Theory. Those are my three, and Seth.
Can you imagine if Austin Theory is in the main event on Day Two of WrestleMania with Brock and Roman? I don't think the wrestling community on Twitter, media in general, are just going to be, what's up?
Wait a minute. But maybe, wouldn't he face someone else maybe? If that doesn't happen then? What if it doesn't happen? What if it's Austin Theory versus just Lashley or Brock or, I don't know. You know, it could be somebody else.
I think he should be
at the end though. I think he should be the guy possibly third eliminated, like one of the last people eliminated. Austin Theory almost makes it.
In my childhood dream, I would love to see Rock back, because again, I love Rock. He was my favorite growing up, but still, I don't believe he's going to be in the Rumble.
Yeah, I didn't either.
I will say this. You want to talk about a legend being in the Royal Rumble, in the male Royal Rumble, why not Sean Waltman?
Yeah, that'd be cool. No, I think he could be in the Rumble. Yeah, that'd be cool.
Yeah, because he hasn't been on a pay-per-view with WWE in forever.
Yeah.
He hasn't wrestled, I don't think, in a major company since TNA.
Can you imagine if Stone Cold showed up in the Rumble?
Oh my god, he'd break his knees.
Dude, I'd flip out, dude. I would come on glue. I would go into outer space.
He just stuns everybody, drinks a beer, and then he eliminates himself because he gets tipsy.
Yeah.
Goes over the top.
Because I wasn't ready to go on tour. I just want to come on and beat some ass. They paid me to kick ass. I would freak out. But I mean, he's so
old. Looks like my little lass needs a shaving.
The lass.
Shell, you make me spray more white liquid than Kurt Angle's milk truck.
No.
Speaking of milk, Vince should bring back the corporation just so Dewdrop can lactate all over them in the ring. Gargut serves bad quesadillas out of a stolen van. Maurice is husky.
Whoa.
God.
That is
it's
wild. Yeah, that is very. I mean, I'm visualizing it right now. By the way, Mr. Pico's birthday, MLK who? What that means?
Wow.
I've been taking shots.
You trying to throw shade, bro?
Yeah, taking shots at MLK tonight.
Do you want a taste, bro? You want a taste?
Nah, man. I don't know what that means, but.
Super Chat Party!
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Theory Angle proves what DX said. Vince loves cocks.
Vince loves cocks. Yes, no, for sure he does. Listen, I mean, this is definitely something I've believed for years. So I think that's why he kept Pat Patterson around. You know?
Wow, everybody in the chat is basically typing in MLK. This is so messed up.
MLK what?
MLK who? Like, I can understand Shell doing it because she's Canadian.
What does that mean? I don't even know what that means.
MLK who?
I mean, I know what
looks
it means.
Like,
but
my little lass needs a shaving.
Camus to Popos. Ayo Rastafa, are you Muslim? Your name sounds very similar to Mustafa. You are in my good books, Rastafa. Get Sandos. Jasmine, first I coat her and Colonel's comments deep fry her chicken fat.
Oh.
Again, very specific.
God damn, man. Colonel Santos. Yeah, I mean, listen, Jasmine has, man, I bet you she's wild, dude. That must be a fun time for her husband or whatever they do. She's gorgeous, man. You know.
Santos, shout out to you, brother. Thank you for the love, man. Yeah, no, I'm not Muslim. I'm actually I'm a practicing Christian, but at the end of the day, though, I respect everybody equally.
He's terrorist.
The Viper has arrived. I'm feeling really mysterious.
Randy Viper, really mysterious, is the king of the wheel of Monetize This.
From out of nowhere.
Friday nights at 11 right here. Friday nights Monetize This. Make sure you come over there if you haven't been there before.
Oh, yeah. We got a new subscriber. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Freak out.
Wrestle Mayo subscribe. How you doing, man?
I don't know why that made me pop.
I do that all the time when I explode. I'm like, and I'm wrestling my own mayonnaise. Comes right out.
Wait, you wrestling mayonnaise?
Yeah, like when I shoot my load out. It's like I'm wrestling mayonnaise all over my hands.
Patty mayonnaise?
That's what I miss about having a in.
Oh, God.
It was like extra sexy. It was like, you know, beaming all over. And it was like, yeah, there it is. But on a girl, on a white girl, it's like, is it then? Oh, there it is. I sort of see it. It's blending in with your creamy skin. You know, so yeah.
In the words of John Cena on a Thanksgiving episode of SmackDown many years ago, he's like, I like to sprinkle my whatever on your chocolate mousse.
Put my chocolate mousse. I got plenty of chocolate mousse myself, man. I'll tell you what, them girls are the best.
Hey, Ray, let's get to the main event before I lose my lunch.
You're going to lose your lunch over sexy women? What the hell's wrong with you?
No, I literally just had a piece of salmon in my mouth and I just didn't want to, gurgle, you know, if you will.
I don't know why, but piece of salmon in my mouth sounds gross. Like, it sounds
salmon? It's healthy, bro.
I know, I love salmon. It's my favorite, like, food almost, but just sounds, the word salmon never sounded very good to me. Love it.
Just the syllables of what makes salmon salmon.
Yeah, like, I feel like salmon should be called sexy. Like, it's sexy fish. Like, like, you know, something like night crystallized fish or something like fun or whatever. But salmon.
Fish.
Yeah, that's salmon. Like, it just sounds, yeah. I don't know. It's a weird thing, but.
Yeah. I'm
weird.
Bobby Lashley versus Seth freaking Rollins.
By the way,
they put freaking in between Seth and Rollins on the little cue card when they show it. Like on television, which I believe that's the first time I've actually ever seen that. So apparently they're really taking that seriously.
Oh, no, they renamed him on the website to Seth Freakin' Rollins on WWE.com, yeah.
Well, I guess that's their way of being, hey, we're PG, but we try to be a little edgy. No.
Yeah, that was weird. Very strange.
Yeah. Obviously, another commercial break within this match. They're fighting a tooth to nail. Seth is, like, you know, trying to avoid certain dangers here. And, of course, belly-to-belly suplex. Rollins lands badly. Lashley sets up for the end, but Shelton and Cedric Alexander pretty much interfere, which causes a disqualification. Lashley just raises hell, suplexes Shelton Benjamin hard, as well as Cedric Alexander. And then, of course, for the finishing touch, Bobby Lashley pretty much does what we call, you know, the Lesnar Goldberg spot, and pretty much spears, I believe it was Cedric Alexander, right through the guardrail area. Seth Rollins is like, oh my God, that looks dangerous. I got to get the heck up out of here. The Usos, God bless the Usos, run out from the crowd, jump over the guardrail, are preparing to do
start
one
drinking.
Of their favorite. Yeah, I guess you're drinking the Kool-Aid. And super kick, double super kick, Seth Rollins right in the face, ends the show. So, Yeah, I mean, again, at this point, Seth could go down like this and not lose any credibility, because a lot of times you think, oh, this makes somebody look weak. No, this is just sending a message and to cross-pollinate with Raw and SmackDown, at least in a creative way. But again, we're seeing this more often where Raw and SmackDown guys are not staying in their own lane, but unless if you're Brock Lesnar, which technically is a free agent if you think about it.
Right.
I mean, again, this is another reason why. I mean, why do we have so many titles? And then again, why do we have so many? I mean, again, we have a lot of talent and it's great, but it's like, you got to, balance out the shows with the right amount of talent. Even if somebody gets injured, you still got somebody from NXT you can call up. So that way it's like we don't have people warming the bench at home. And then you're wondering why, we're hiring all this talent just to keep out of other promotions, which, again, Vince and the WWE are like the hungry, hungry hippos of professional wrestling or sports entertainment, whatever you want to call it. They'll gobble up every natural resource, every great talent, every great, Mike Talker, Skywalker, whatever. And then, of course,
Flip Flopper, Skywalker, Mike Talker, Tyke.
Looks like my little lass needs a shaving.
F. Martin Luther King's corpse.
Oh.
The Colonel matters, not some. Frostafuzz schlong down your throat and you will choke to death. You will finally see a BBC.
Did he just say my name and you use the term BBC?
I don't know. I'm going to stay away from that whole donation.
Oh my gosh.
I'm going to not comment on that whole thing that he just said.
Yeah, I'm not touching that one with a 10-foot pole, even though he referenced my 10-foot pole.
What the fuck? I'm not even. That's.
Did he say Negro?
He said. Well, it was worse than that.
Super chat party.
Jesus. I can't even believe that got through the censors.
Rumble could be set up for almost to win. That suck.
Oh my god. Yeah. You know what? We were saying that it was a couple weeks ago that we were joking, or at least I was joking, about almost winning the Rumble. And I'm sorry. I have to bail on that now. That just is. I just can't even see that now. I just, even as bad, as much as they would do that, I even have to bail on that. I was excited about how silly that could be, but I even have to bail on that. I can't even joke that would happen.
Yeah, I mean, at this point right now, I'm not surprised by anything really that they do.
Right.
Super chat party!
Oh, yeah?
One man and one man only wins the Rumble. Barry Horowitz.
I mean, that if that was going to happen, I still think that should have happened like back in the... You remember the WrestleMania where Vince won? I think it would have been funny if one guy was left and it was Barry Horowitz and he came out and eliminated Vince. That would have been the time to do it. That's the only time that would have worked.
Or Bob Backlund or somebody like that, yeah.
Yeah, something weird like that, because that way Vince doesn't actually win... but he kind of screwed over Austin.
You just imagine if a fan was in the crowd.
Whoa, that scared the shit out of me. Holy shit.
Veer will be one of the last four. Send Veer.
Oh God, you're right. Veer will probably be last too.
Oh, in the Rumble, boom, dude. Boom. What if they debuted him in the Rumble?
That could happen, but that's a bad. That's a mistake if he's not going to win, right? That's a really dumb. I think.
Or at least not in the bottom six.
Yeah, I wouldn't put him in the Rumble, but they could. I mean, they've done that with people in the past, debuted them, and they've had good showings, and then they get eliminated. But yeah, I wouldn't debut. I would debut him in a match at the Rumble. Like the first match of the night is Veer, again, an open challenge, and it's Veer. It's somebody. It's the 10,000. It's the $100,000 open challenge, and that starts the Royal Rumble off, and. I don't know. And it's Veer. Veer wins the 100,000. You know, I don't know, whatever. Stuff like that. I'm always and fuck that gimmick. Just whatever. Just have him in a match at the Rumble. You don't
I just realized something. How many big guys that are, I guess, you know, trained or whatever that are in that on Raw, let alone, that are big guys and they barely work like in a program? Like, for example, Apollo's manager, Omos, Veer. Again, normally what happens is like there'll be moments in matches and sometimes even in the Rumble where you got like two big guys and all the fans go, oh, these guys are about to go at it. Who's going to drop first type of thing?
Yeah.
Honestly, I just get the sense that a lot of these guys, although they have great size and most likely some credible athleticism in other areas, it's just going to fall flat on his face. I just really am not buying this. And if you're a kid and you're with your parents and it's a family thing, which again, it's a family show, I get it. You'll enjoy it. But if you're consistently watching this on a weekly basis and there's really no story or build or even people getting better, it's just a waste.
Yeah, I'm concerned about this Rumble, but I'm always excited about the Rumbles, so I will be excited. It will be fun in the time we're watching it, but I do worry about this Rumble. But hey, we'll see what happens. I'm up against the time. I'm going to roll on out of here. What do you think? Final closing statements here. And by the way, great job tonight. Mustafa broke, you know, went down the line of everything for us here. You know, but what do you think? What would you give the show tonight? Where are you at with it?
Oh, God. Honestly, I'll give Maurice, just because if Maurice was on, it was MLK Day, I'll give the show a 3 out of 10.
3 out of 10 from Mustafa. I'm actually right there with you. I give it exactly a 3 out of 10. You know, good job executing a smooth show. Too many commercials, as always. And just generic kid stuff. If you're under the age of 11, if you're 11 or less, you will enjoy this probably, maybe.
unless if you're Brody's kids and then you're like, nope, hate this.
Yeah, I mean, like when I was a kid, you know, when I was 11 and 12, I loved the Ultimate Warrior showing up again, Shawn Michaels and Bret Hart, you know, things like that. So I could see an 11, 12-year-old liking it. I think it was around the age of 13 that I was like, man, maybe I'm done watching wrestling. I don't know. And then that was when Attitude came in and saved me, so... but if you're a 13, 14, 15-year-old nowadays, I got to believe you're tuning out of this. Unless you like torture at that age. I can't imagine it. Then again, I'm 37 watching this. That's it, man. Mustafa, have a good night, man. Thanks for being here. Happy MLK Day to everybody. Shout out to Martin Luther King, man. Some of the best quotes, badass statements, and real as shit you ever heard.
Absolutely.
And it can go for anybody, man. That's why it can unite everybody, because all the words matter to everybody. They connect us all. So, awesome shit from Martin Luther King. That was probably one of the better parts of the whole fucking show. But we see it every year when they honor him.
Put over MLK over this crap Raw show.
Yeah, I mean, MLK, I mean, we cut a promo that would, you know, way better than anybody in the company. MLK's a better promo. Watching him fucking talk, I'm like, this guy cuts a better promo than all these fucking people on this show.
Okay. Oh my gosh, dude, thank you for allowing me to be on here with you. I know, like, you know, we're pressed for time, but dude, I've always wanted to actually do this with you. I know, even though that Jake is not with us, but yo, anytime, you know, I'm willing to do this with you. Definitely let me know, and I'll definitely try to help you out as much as possible.
Yeah, man, I really appreciate it. You're great. You are always great, man. When you're on, we love when you're on. And I like it. I like when it adds another dynamic. I'm sure some nights I'll be off on a rant and. You know what I mean? But I will try to bring you on all the time if I can, if you're around. You know, and certainly while Jake's gone, it helps keep me, you know, focused on what we're talking about. And, you know, if I feel, you know, especially if I'm not in the mood to rant on anything, there's nothing much to rant about. If I was ready to rant, you know, sure, I would go into those and I'd bring you on later. But, you know, it's better to have that structure when I'm not ready to rant. So appreciate it. And, you know, I've known you for fucking 8 years now, I feel like, or 7 years or something.
And by the way, shout out to Maurice's Apple Bottom. Hashtag Apple Bottom on Twitter. Hashtag Joe Cronin Show. Why not?
Right. Hell yeah, man. Everybody tweet her. Hope we can get her on here. Get me off. All right. Bye, Mustafa. Thank you, man.
see you.
Good night, bro. Thank you to Mustafa. Thank you to everybody who donated during the stream, man. You guys are the best. Look at his look.
Hey, look at his look.
How he looks. The $6 donation. We actually didn't even hear the $6 donation tonight, so here you go.
And look at his look.
Robert Heller, man. Robert Heller. Robert, thank you. Veer will be the last in the Rumble, man. That kills me. Thanks for coming in with the Venti Uno, man. Mr. Pico Boulevard, Alex Oli, Colonel Santos, Wrestling, Wrestle Mayo, Randy Viper, Colonel Santos, Alex Oli, The Soundwave 92, Shell, 21 months on YouTube, and D. Welsh and everybody else. Thank you guys for hitting it up. I hope you guys have a good Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Tomorrow I'll be on with some shit for you. And at some point Wednesday night for AEW, I'll be live for the AEW review as always. And we'll have something for you Thursday night. And then, of course, Friday night, Monetize This. Be here around 11 o'clock for Monetize This Friday night. Really Mysterious, the king of the wheel, Rose Montana. Keep it hard. Everybody else, thank you. Hit that like button on the way out, man. Let's see if we can get the likes up. We really need the likes up. I don't know what they're at, but they're too low. 146. We need to get at least 169. Let's click that thumb, stick it up my ass. And Leah, did you know John Madden's dead, Leah?
EA Sports, it's in the grave.
Oh, good Lord. Good night, everybody. Why is Owens grabbing his balls here?
I gave it to Debbie.
Die, you fat asshole!
Big huge sausage fest. I had to hop in.
Oh, the black kid got arrested for doing black things.